So, you know, I was asked to speak today, and you know, I don't know how much you've had a chance to hear the story, the Amiga story, from these honorable and significant players in the industry. I've had a chance to speak a few times myself over the years, and a lot of the stories have been told, and a lot of the things that we think you want to hear, we've already said. What I've discovered is a great way to handle my speaking is to give you this speech. Once upon a time, I helped make the Amiga computer. The end. Any questions? I'd much rather take questions from you guys, and we thought it would be great to have the three of us stay on stage together and just have it be an open session here, where instead of you sitting and listening to a speech, let's have it be interactive. If you guys have any questions, we'd be delighted to answer them. If you don't have questions, we can make stuff up. But before I talk, I just want to say one thing. Before we hand the microphone to you guys, I just want to say one thing. I was just talking about the early Amiga experience and remembered something that I'd kind of forgotten. And I can't speak for these gentlemen, but I can speak for myself. The fun and interesting and most amazing thing about that entire experience for me is that when I started out, I was just this guy. I was just this kid from the south side of Chicago. I had a lot of dreams, I had a lot of hopes, but I didn't have a lot of experience, I didn't have a lot of credentials that would make someone believe in me. I believed in myself, and I pushed real hard to see the things that I wanted to have become reality. They became reality because I was helping with them. But I was really just this guy from the south side of Chicago, nothing, no, like me. And anyone who knows me, anyone who spent some years with me can attest, I'm no like genius or anything like that. I just, you know, love the stuff that I do. I have the passion for the stuff that I do. And I think that's what set Amiga apart more than anything else. It was this collection of people that believed and couldn't wait to see this stuff become a reality. And I'm saying this to you because this applies to each and every one of you. You just gotta look in your own heart, you gotta believe in yourself, and you can do it as well. You can create the stuff, you can invent the future in the same way that we did 30 years ago. And we can't do more than encourage you to find that in yourselves.
Yeah, I just wanted to say, on a similar vein, I got handed the Amiga 2000 project to complete by myself when I was 2 years out of college. And I looked at it and I said, I think I can do this, but it's going to be scary. And I better not screw it up. But on the other hand, if you're doing something that doesn't scare you, you're probably going to get bored. Yeah. There was no getting bored at Commodore.
There was no certainty, you know? We were there, we were, you know, newly acquainted, weren't sure who was doing what exactly, and yeah, you know, it's funny, you can always look at it in retrospect, you know, 30 years later, here we are looking at like, oh, you guys knew exactly what you're doing, it was just like perfect and all that, like, no, it was that passion, and you know, everyone pitched into that passion. It was amazing how there were no slackers at Amiga. And we were sleeping at our desks, and we just loved the concept of what we were making. And that, you know, regardless of what you make, whether it's art or technology or whatever it is, that's, I think, the passion, and that's the reason you flew wherever you flew from or drove or, you know, took the train to get here. It's that drives, and that was the same as us. So it just, you know, pattern repeats.
So, any questions? Okay, first.
I'll throw the mic.
Please state your name, sir.
The Mad Fool. It's one question, which could be two, or I'll let you answer. Obviously, Dave is a Commodore guy, and Commodore was Amiga Sega, right? Jack Tramiel was the late Jack Tramiel was a leading force, a dominant force in Commodore. If he had stayed, how do you think that would have affected the three of you?
I've got one thing I'll say about that. I had a picture that I have of Jack Mail that I put on my door of my office. It was just a picture of him. He looked really mean in this picture. And I said, don't forget, never forget who this is. Because when he left Commodore, he was really pissed. He was like a rattlesnake ready to kill. Okay, and he bought Atari, and he's like, I'm going to kill Amiga. And how would it have been different?
We'd be dead.
Yeah, we'd be dead. It wouldn't have been the same. I don't think it would have been the same.
No.
The creative license that we had was unbelievable. And it was due to Jay, and it was due to Dave Morris. I don't know how much you've heard that name, Dave Morris. Incredible guy. Also, RJ went on to work with Dave many times afterwards. I did too. My video stream startup was with Dave. Just an incredible guy, very soft-spoken. Never took credit for himself, but man, could that guy make executive decisions. Unbelievable. He wasn't the management I went to when I was having problems. It was the middle management that was a problem. Dave was something else. So, just the right guy.
You know, and I'll add one thing. You hear a lot, I've heard already today, a lot of commentary about Commodore this and Commodore didn't do that and advertising and marketing and yada, yada, yada. I agree with all of that. And who knows what the Amiga had been if that had been different. Who knows what the Amiga had been if Jack had stayed in charge and used it as a cannon. Who knows what would have happened with that? I don't know. But I one thing that is not said enough about Commodore is just how awesome it was to be bought by Commodore. Amiga was a death's door. We were starved. We were out of oxygen. And back in the old days, there was 10 of us working on this little Sage multi-user computer that was supposed to take 4 at most, and we had 10 of us burdening the thing, and then Commodore came in with a big checkbook and bought us real development equipment and gave us all the elbow room and bought real stuff for the hardware guys to use to develop real hardware. It was a huge breath of fresh air for us, and that part of the story is not told often enough, and you guys got to remember that too. The Commodore was a savior. Commodore came in and saved the day. If it weren't for Commodore, we wouldn't have the Amiga that we have today.
I only worked under Jack for a short period of time, but the one thing I have a pretty good suspicion that Jack was... He would listen to engineers more than anybody else. He didn't really listen to anybody, but engineers he had respect for. On the other hand, he really did want it here in his fist. He wanted to control it. So there's an awfully good chance when Commodore bought Amiga, Marshall Smith was in charge, and this guy didn't know what he was doing. But he made the right decision buying Amiga. And I think that level of did the right thing, confused about it, not sure what to do, allowed Amiga in California to stay alive a lot longer. If Jack had bought it, there's an awfully good chance it would have all been brought to Westchester, and most of these guys would have left, because nobody really wants to live in Westchester, Pennsylvania. I've never actually lived in Pennsylvania except when I was in college, even when I worked at Commodore. So in later years, I would have liked to have a guy like Jack around, because we got to a point where nobody in management would listen to anything engineering had to say. And Jack always did listen to engineering, at least if they were the engineers he had under his thumb at Westchester. So, you know, it's a mixed bag. It would have been completely different, and I think it would have turned out a lot like Atari did, where they wouldn't have treated the Amiga as a real platform. They would have treated it like they did. It would have been more like the Commodore 64, where you ship something and it's done. You don't keep working on it. You're going to work on the next thing. From the hardware point of view, the only way I could make things last was to build platforms, not to build a single product, because I knew Commodore wasn't going, you know, as I mentioned before, it wasn't going to come out with a new computer every year. So, you know, Jack, I think, you know, I had a lot of respect for what he did in the 8-bit era, because that was kind of the right way to do the 8-bit era, but I, you know, the fact that Jack wasn't there didn't mean that we had the right people at Commodore, but I think if, you know, that actually we had the opportunity to have the right people at Commodore, I don't think Jack would have been overall a positive asset for the Amiga.
I don't think so. I'll tell you one last Jack Tramiel story, just to give you a sort of a picture of what kind of guy he was. I think this little story encapsulates a lot of Jack. The very last time I saw him, the very last time I met him, I was at a restaurant in Palo Alto, in California. And he recognized me and came over to the table to say hello to me. And he was sort of gloating over the fact that the Amiga had not been super successful, and he was expressing and kind of digging a little bit at me that I hadn't quite made it, and the Amiga hadn't quite made it. And it hurt, but I didn't care because, you know, I was having a fine dinner in Palo Alto, and I just didn't care. But while he was standing there and gloating over the fact that the Amiga hadn't made it, the guy pulls out a cigar. Here in a restaurant in California, I don't know about where you live, but you can't smoke cigars in a restaurant in California. But he lit the thing up, and he's standing there, gloating over me, Jack Tramiel, like this guy that a lot of people didn't like, smoking a cigar and poking his finger at me. And the waitress, the person that's serving the food in the restaurant, comes up to him and tells him, you can't do that. You can't smoke a cigar here in the restaurant like that anymore. And he glares at her. And he glared at her until she turned and walked away. And that was Jack Tramiel. But then he had the common sense to put his cigar out before the manager made it over to my table. And that was Jack Tramiel too. Any other questions? Good, over here. Marvin, you got it?
Who, what?
Over here.
Ah, he's called John. Is that what this is?
Hi there. I was just wondering, on the internet, Amiga information is everywhere. But who were the designers of the cases, the house?
Well, the Amiga 3000 case was guy named Herb Mosteller. I think he did the 500 as well. The 2000, I have no idea. That came from Germany. We weren't happy with it, particularly me, because I had to deal with the fact that all the mouse signals had to run past the DRAM, the noisiest part of the whole system, and we still had to pass FCC. But yeah, it was, yeah, her, I mean, I like the 3000 case. I don't, you know, some people, but, you know, the toaster people didn't like it because they had to change the toaster a little bit, but I thought it was really cool.
It's the most iconic.
Yeah, I you know, and that was, you know, I didn't have any control over any of that really, but I, you know, I always offered ideas, and, we had, it was all done in house. We didn't farm it out. And that's, you know, Commodore did pretty much everything
in our system.
I like the Amiga 1000 case. I remember when they came in with the foam plastic one, you know, and they were like, what do you think of this, guys? The keyboard goes underneath. Remember that? I think you said on your desk. It's like, yes.
Yes, must have.
Who was the industrial designer then? Do you remember?
What's his name? Howard Dean? Howard.
I hope it's Howard Dean.
Sorry, Howard, if I got your last name wrong.
Howard. Yeah, a lot of people don't know it, but there was, that idea was kind of spiked for the, we had this thing called the Commodore 128D, which was a Commodore 128 with a built-in disk drive, and the original, not the one that shipped, but the original plastic, instead of a garage, there was a clip, and you could snap your keyboard in the bottom, and there's a handle on it, you can carry it with you. I mean, the thing weighed like 25 pounds, but
I have one at home. I do. I have one of the portable.
Yeah. Eventually, the one that actually shipped was made of metal. This was all plastic case, and our case designers were thinking about different things. They didn't always work. They didn't always ship. Some of them wouldn't pass FCC, but it was fun. I mean, they came up with some pretty innovative ideas here and there.
What about the C65?
The C65 is an anomaly. Nobody really knows why that existed. It had a lot to do with, there was this chip engineer, Bill Gardai, and nobody wanted to work with him. And near the end of Commodore, he decided he was just going to go and make this Commodore 65, and I'm not really sure how much management was convinced that it was a good thing to do and how much was just like, go away, Bill, do whatever you want, whatever. But anyway, yeah, it was, I mean, I was a little, what bothered me about it was, if we had gotten that kind of support for the C128, we would have sold, you know, 12 or 24 million rather than just 6. Because that, you know, all the stuff we wanted, we weren't allowed to make big changes to the big chip, we weren't allowed to do this. We knew what we wanted, we just couldn't get it. C65 got all of that, and nobody was paying really any attention, and I'm not even sure if they had a goal of what they were going to do with it once it was done. But if you have one, they're very valuable.
A prototype has been sold in the Netherlands for $12,000.
Yeah, $12,000.
It's up there with the Apple
One. I'll come to you, Trevor. Meanwhile, you tell the story about the workbench, floppy hand.
Oh, about the workbench, the floppy hand. So I get this question a lot, and it's interesting that it's a mystery question. Do you remember the original Amiga 1000, the one that we first created that we launched to the public? And if you can picture the 1000, it's here. And the disk drive is over here on the right-hand side, so that if you were going to go put the workbench disk in, or the kickstart, you'd put it in, like that, right? But many people noticed that the hand holding the kickstart is actually not this hand, but this hand. The hand is holding the kickstart as if you use your left hand. And I've been asked dozens of times over the years, why is it held in the left hand when in fact you have to hold it in the right hand to insert it into the drive? And here's the amazing answer that you will never have guessed. The artist, of course, was right-handed. Let's see, what does that look like?
Cheryl Knowles. And her husband wrote the original adventure game. If you know that one with the twisty little passages, all look the same, all different. Yeah. Had a good group. And Jack Hagar did all that wonderful graphics for things like, you know, these shirts. This is the original pressing of one of these shirts that this is the Amiga Computer Ink. Yeah.
I'm so jealous.
You've got one.
Mine is medium. These days, extra large.
I barely had to stretch this one out a bit.
Okay. My question is, I shouldn't really mention the name, but I'll mention it anyway. Mehdi Ali. It's really for RJ and Dave, because I guess you were no longer involved with the Commodore at that stage.
Actually, I spent a lot of time with Mehdi.
Oh, you did.
Yeah, it was Irving and Mehdi that pushed CDTV so hard. So I spent actually a lot of time talking to them and getting to know them for that project.
Well, there's been so much written about Mehdi Ali and how he destroyed Commodore. But is that, first question, is it really true? And secondly, if you look at his official website, it's how he restructured and saved Commodore. So it's quite an interesting concept. So what do you think about that?
Be careful.
Well, Mehdi Ali, it's easy to sum it up. This was a guy who took over Commodore. He'd been basically a financial hatchet man for Prudential. Prudential was this big insurance company that got all this money and it didn't know what to do with it, so they invested it in companies. Mehdi Ali was pretty much this guy who, and they had invested in Commodore, which is I think where Mehdi first ran into Commodore. He would go to a company and that was not performing well enough for Prudential's taste and hack and slash, and I think they, you know, he made recommendations and they would implement some of them, but they weren't required to implement all of them, and they'd get profitable enough for Prudential to pull their money out. And that's, I guess there's, you know, for Prudential that's a good business, but that's no way to run a computer company. So we had various other guys running various parts of Commodore. We had Jack, we had Radigan, the Pepsi guy coming in, which is why we kept drinking Coke. But he came in and like learned about Commodore. We had Henry Rubin, who ran engineering for a while, who didn't know, he was like a mechanical engineer or something. He had an engineering background, which was good, because that's what you want in a manager, and he'd done management. He was a little bit crazy, but we're all mad here anyway, so. Crazy in kind of a good way, kind of a bad way, but between the management at the time at Commodore worked, we had found a way to make it work very well. We just needed more money, but Henry always had the fastest Amiga I could deliver him on his desk. He had all the software. He was doing all of his work on Amigas. If it didn't do it right, he would call a software company or whatever to complain about it not being, because he would not use a PC because he wanted the experience. He wanted to know what we were doing right. He wanted to know what we were doing wrong. And a lot of us were like that. I was making my own toys, so of course I've got an Amiga on my desk. But you know, Henry, you know, as a manager, you don't have to. So, Mehdi Ali was a guy who didn't watch television and didn't use a computer and had no bloody idea why a computer that did television was a good thing, and he didn't make any efforts to figure out why. A good manager will say, well, I don't know these things, but I will surround myself, I'll meet all the people in the company who know these things, and they're going to help me. Mehdi Ali met all those people and fired them and put his own flunkies in place of that, and just decided he knew what was best, which for the first 6 months or so was, well, actually, first six months he was messing with the rest of the company. He didn't get around to engineering until about halfway through 91. In February of 91, the Amiga 3000 Plus with the AA chips, or the Pandora chips as we call them, booted for the first time. We were looking at delivering a product before April of 92, which had the DSP in it and a bunch of other really cool stuff. It had 16-bit audio, it had a bunch of stuff that was added on. It wasn't in the chipset, but it was added on. So they brought Mehdi Ali, hired a guy called Bill Sidney's, whose claim to fame was two things. He was the guy at Franklin Computer who thought that copying the Apple ROM to make a clone wasn't such a big deal. And he was the guy at IBM who made the PC Junior. So this is a very talented individual we're talking about. He was put in charge of Commodore's engineering, and Henry was kicked out. And Jeff Porter, who I worked for, was pushed aside. He was still there. In fact, Jeff Porter was the only reason we had an Amiga 3000 Plus at all. He kept it going even after these guys came in. They tried for 6 months or so to turn Commodore into a PC-only company and kill the Amiga. And then at some point they realized that even if they made PCs, they couldn't make cost-effective PCs, because you could, at that time in 92, 91, you could buy a PC motherboard from one of these big Taiwanese PC board makers for less than it cost Commodore to make a board that we designed ourselves, and also not have to hire all those engineers and pay all that engineering cost to develop it. So they basically screwed themselves. Bill Sidney's was actually brought into Commodore under Mehdi to make what we were calling the A300, which already existed, by the way. A lot of people didn't know that George Robbins had an A300 design, which was exactly what was described in the early days. It was like an A500 without a disk and small, no keyboard pad. And it actually had a super cheap, like the cheapest Genlock known to mankind, is what we used to say. When we made the 040 card for the A4000, that was described as, Scott Schaefer was the guy who did that, and Greg Berlin asked Scott Schaefer, said, make the cheapest 040 card known to mankind. So we made this. It had a cheap Genlock built into the thing, so people were going to be able to plug it directly into their VCR and start doing stuff. It was really cool, and Bill Sidney's came in and promised to make that product niche for $50 less cost than the A500, and ended up costing like $100 more than the A500, and they let Bill Sidney's go. But Mehdi was still around, and he was just constantly screwing things up. You couldn't tell him anything. Jeff Porter had fights with him all the time about stuff, and you know, he'd sit there and listen and then completely ignore you. So, I mean, this was not a guy who was trying to make a company that lasted. And there was a lot of talk about all the shenanigans that went on at the end. You could call shenanigans just about everything. I mean, they were fighting to make sure that the bankruptcy took place under the rules of the Bahamas, because otherwise they'd have to open their books for a whole year. There was all kinds of bad things happening all at once. And yeah, so I think, it wasn't in a vacuum, because Irving Gold could have fired many anytime he wanted. But the two of them pretty much put Commodore in the coffin. It wasn't Microsoft, it wasn't Apple, it was a suicide of sorts. That's my opinion anyway.
So my perspective of Mehdi and of Irving is completely different, because I wasn't at Commodore East Coast. I was over in California working out of a small town in Northern California. And when CDTV started, when that project began, the first thing that I was told is go out and talk to Irving and Mehdi and get to know them. And I sat down with Irving and he said, we want Commodore to come back into this consumer market in a big way, and we think this concept of CDTV would bring us there and return us into that space. Because he remembered the heyday of Commodore when they were selling 25 million, computers into the home. People don't realize how much, what a powerhouse Commodore was in the computing arena. When Amiga was acquired, the Wall Street Journal ran a full page announcement, I guess it was, and Commodore actually put up a bar chart that showed IBM and all the other companies that made computers and how many computers they had sold. And next to it, they had the bar chart of Commodore computers, which I think at that point was 25 million. Yeah. And it just went off the page, went off to the top of the page. And it was a really good illustration of where were computers, coming from and who was selling them. So I had a really good conversation with them. My opinion of Mehdi was he was very selective in the way that he dealt with business. So he was actually one of the smartest people, one of the most brilliant people I've ever dealt with in management. But it was very precise, kind of banker way of thinking. Okay, so it's like, tell me when it's going to be done, tell me how much it's going to cost. Okay, and I had been pretty good with that in my career, figuring out, okay, here's what's going to be done, here's what it's going to cost. And so the CDTV developed kind of as a skunk works outside of Commodore. And, there were many times when we needed cash for these Japanese, can you send me a check for $200,000? And within a week, we'd have the check. And so it was, he really greased those, skids really well for CDTV. And so that was my experience with him, which was different. And one of the things I think that was most interesting about the man was he never kept a shred of documentation at all. Okay, his desk was totally clean. If you sent him an email, he'd delete it. If you sent him a paper copy of something, he'd read it and shred it. There was nothing. He had it all up here. He kept everything as much as he could. He kept it up there. And so I have an interesting story, because the first startup I did after CDTV was to try to take CDTV and put it into an industrial market, because it wasn't making it well in the consumer market. So go into education, take it to schools, universities, educational products for industry. And I actually convinced Mehdi Ali to finance that company. And it wasn't cheap. And he did it, and he wrote the check. So that was my experience, which was different. But I can see that in managing a technology company, you need to be a lot more than a banker. And I think that's really the big weakness that you saw. Yeah.
To close this, if you guys just noticed, the two long-standing players in the Amiga industry and who were really connected with the players of the company, and they have these diametrically opposed opinions of this one serious player. Sadly, this is kind of indicative of how the whole thing went. There was ups and downs and beliefs and disbeliefs, and people weren't talking with each other, or when they weren't being truthful and honest with each other, and that's a large part of what caused it to crumble in the end, was that lack of sincere honesty and desire to work together that we had in the beginning.
And making PCs rather than Amigas. and building up a huge inventory of PCs when the PC market went dead or flat. Yeah.
I have a question that's on my mind here.
we all know the winners, the industry winners of today, like Apple, of course, and all the other tech companies, but Apple was broke at 97. But can you give us direction, which kind of disruptive technology we should invest in as a company today to make it big in the future? Because when you look at how the world at global industry is working right now, the technology is so all around us and available that probably it's very hard to compete against all those big companies. But what direction should we go if we wanted to make a decision to make something great like you did?
My answer to that, did everyone hear the question? My answer to that is simple: online, connected. It doesn't matter what else you do, but it's got to be connected today. That we've got to find ways to increase the way we connect to each other, the way we communicate with each other, the conscious stuff that we do sharing, but we've also got to increase that unconscious bandwidth where we know where one another is and we know what's going on with one another's lives. That social and connectivity stuff is only going to become more and more important as the next years go by, and that's where I've been putting all of my bets for the last 10 years, is, you know, believing in the internet, believing in streaming, believing that bandwidth is only gonna get bigger, hardware is only gonna get faster. I'm kind of scared that, you know, we did the math a long time ago and realized that our smartphones, our phones in our pockets have become as powerful as the original Amiga computer. I did the math the other day, this thing is as powerful as a PlayStation 2. That we're all now walking around with these things in our pockets, and that's where the future is going. More power, more bandwidth, more connectivity. That's what I think you ought to be thinking about seriously.
But there's also, you know, Kickstarter, and there's also, you know, Fitbit and GoPro and all kinds of models of guys that aren't too different than any of us in this room that had an idea of some kind and thought, you know, I've got friends that want this. I want this for myself. And if you can find the money to finance it one way or the other, a lot of those dreams can come true, even in hardware and software and, you know, social, whatever, you know, apps on the phones, whatever. But you gotta drive through. And I guess the one piece of advice that I can give is, if you really believe in something, don't let anyone tell you otherwise. Okay? Continue to follow it. Even if your best friends or your employees or whatever, buddies, are saying, you know, that'll never make it, if you believe that that's the right thing to do, and if there, you believe there's a market that will pay money for that, you go do that. And don't stop. Just keep on that track. Solid. Put on your blinders. Don't listen. Do it. That's what those guys did. That's what all those folks that made those companies did.
In hardware, I'm a big fan these days of doing something embedded, something that's basically, you know, you could go out and make a smartphone, but 1,000 other people do that. Application processing, whether it's on the desktop or in your pocket, is pretty much a game of billion-dollar companies. But what you can do is, I mean, it's easier than ever to make something smart that's, you know, it could be portable, it could be like, I have a bathroom scale, because I lost 25 pounds in the last 6 months. So I have a bathroom scale that I step on and it reports my weight to the internet.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, that is, so it's connected and it's a device. But the interesting thing about that is nowhere in that equation is the device driver that's not going to run in Windows 10 or whatever. It's completely independent. There's an API. If you want to get information about that weight that was taken out, you go to the web. And that's, you know, that's a loose piece of what everyone's calling the Internet of Things. But what it really means is that a cheap-ass micro system on a chip thing is powerful enough to have a TCP/IP stack to hit your home router to report stuff onto the net, which means that you are entirely in charge of how people interact with that device, and you don't need an operating system anymore. And, you know, I mean, you can have an operating system in there, but it's yours. You can make another clone of the Amiga operating system if you want to for your bathroom scale. I've been on two projects that kind of clone the Amiga operating system. In fact, the RC car stuff I did had a little kind of a baby exec inside of it. And it was a 16-bit exec for a while. But, you know, I mean, you have to realize how fast things change.
and that, you know, you can control it entirely. When I did my RC car stuff, our first controller had a 16-bit micro with 60K of flash and 4K of RAM. My second generation version, which cost $200 less, had two 32-bit ARM chips in it. And actually, I paid less for that system than I did for the 16-bit stuff. And today you could have like, and actually you could have a pretty powerful ARM in there rather than just a ARM7 TDMI. So I mean, the idea is that you can basically build your own thing, hook it into a network, and you know, your idea has to be a good one or it's not going to succeed. But sometimes, in the past, it was not just that, it was there were a lot of really big hills to climb. And that kind of that area of technology, the hills are much, much more shallow. Getting funding, like RJ mentioned, through Kickstarter is something that if it's that kind of idea, you don't have to go to angels, you don't have to commit, you don't have to convince other people. All you have to do is convince the people who will eventually use it. But if you're doing that, do the math, make damn sure you're going to deliver, because the last thing you want is something like Kickstarter that, that will eventually go away if there's too many projects that don't succeed. So it's right now it's in a good state, but it doesn't always work. And do the math, learn a little bit about business. One thing I've mentioned is that Commodore was the last company I worked for where I couldn't walk on over to the CEO's desk and tell him exactly how I felt. Which means I haven't worked for a large company ever since. I've been on a first name basis with every other CEO that I've worked for. I didn't really, at Commodore they were not accessible. I could go all the way up to the VP in engineering, and I knew some VPs in marketing and sales, but do realize that even if you're a tech person like me, you are responsible for understanding your entire destiny, not just the piece that you're really good at. So that's my advice.
And now that you know that his bathroom scales on the internet, you got 24 hours for him to gain 50 pounds on that.
Hi, Alessandro from Italy. I would have a couple of questions if I can, but anyway, the burning one right now is, how exactly did the A600 come into being? Not quite a 500 plus, it was going to be a 1200, so what happened?
Okay, the A600 was really the A300. I mentioned a little bit of that before. George Robbins and Jeff Porter were talking. Jeff Porter is pretty much responsible for every good idea, or at least, because He was basically the middle management guy in engineering, but really he was like manager of new product development or whatever. But really, he did a lot of the vice presidential work at all, because like I said, Henry was a little bit odd and sort of had his own danced to his own beat, as they say. But so they got together and said we want something cheaper than the A500. That we can sell and get people who couldn't afford it otherwise, expand the markets to Eastern Europe, expand the markets to South America. So George Robbins made this. It was the A300 was an A500 style thing, still 68,000, no keypad, ECS chips. I think it was still 512K, but it was a scaled down A500. And I mentioned that there was George had come up with this super, I have no idea how it works, super cheap Genlock that was like, I mean, it was really, really cheap to build into it so that you would be able to plug this directly into a tape deck and Genlock your home videos, or between your camcorder and your tape deck, you'd be able to Genlock your home videos. And that was one of the things they were trying to do, is to get, we had all this professional video stuff out there, but we wanted to sell something cheap that, consumer would say, oh yeah, I'd like to use that. And it was Bill Sidney's and Mehdi, I'm not really sure who came up with all of the diversions from that, but they basically ran with that idea and added all this extra stuff, and rather than coming out $50 to $100 less cost than the A500, it came out to cost about $100 more. And then they did the thing that, as far as I know, never had happened before in the Commodore's history. The A500 was still selling okay. I mean, this was never supposed to be a replacement for the A500, but because the powers that be were in charge now had made this A600. They canceled the A500, stopped making it, even though it was still selling. And like, Commodore was always the opposite of that. The only time a product ever went away was when people stopped buying it. Yeah, there was some sensibility there, but this was the one time they canceled the A500. And the whole community loved the A500 because you could open it up and stick stuff inside, you could expansion stuff. Meanwhile, we had the PCMCIA slot that was actually like not even properly implemented or something. It wasn't up to the par of the PC stuff. So you had all these cards that could go in there, but most of them wouldn't work, and you needed to write drivers for them, and it was surface mount chips inside, which did save us money, but you couldn't add your stuff inside. So it was just, it was an idea from people who didn't understand what the Amiga market was. And it cost so much that Bill Sidney's got fired over it, which was actually a good thing. But that's really where it came from. I mean, it was just that team, that management team decided this was the product they wanted to make, and they wanted to kill the A500 rather than putting something out that was a complement to it.
How many were made?
I have no idea how many were made. I know they made so many they couldn't sell them the first year. They made a lot of them, and then it just wasn't a fast-moving product. I mean, I'm sure it has its own merits. I worked on a product called the Plus 4 that a lot of people didn't like either. And I met a few people who were crazy about it too. So, I'm not saying it was a terrible product. It was, it was still an Amiga. It still did what it needed to do. It was done wrong.
I got a question for you guys, but before I ask it, I promised my daughter I would do this.
Make a selfie.
This is such an amazing selfie, yeah, from up here.
I got one more.
It's a fun idea, isn't it?
Like, no.
All right, this is a video, so say okay. Cheese.
Cheese.
Okay, and one quick question for you guys. How many people here know that phrase, Genlock, with the video? Do you know what that means, to Genlock with the video? It's weird. It's in this day and age, a lot of people don't know that anymore, and it's becoming smaller every year. Okay, any other questions? Robert gets one.
Yes.
Robert needs to get one.
He's so awesome.
The guy
is a god.
Oh, Dave and Carl and Archie. What do you know, or do you know anything about the story behind Commodore's incursion into the PC area? You know, like the Commodore Colt, the Commodore PC-10, the PC-20, and the PC-30.
Those beautiful machines.
The story, I've heard it, was that Commodore was trying to be an all-services company. Some large buyers in Europe wanted to buy everything from one company. And so they got started, I mean, that's not where it ended up, but they got started making PCs simply to be able to say, look, we sell PCs, you can buy from us and also buy Amigas, rather than those guys going to somebody else. That was the story. That was the justification for it. Most of them were just OEM'd boards, but then we started doing... They started hiring PC people in the late 80s to do some internal development, which was a really stupid idea considering the direction that PC technology was going and how commodified it was. But that's what they did, and so once they had those people, they started having to use them, and eventually they ran engineering. In like 91, when Bill Sidney's came in, Bill Sidney's, as I mentioned, was an IBM PC junior guy, but he was still a PC guy, and he put the lead of the PC group, Jeff Frank, basically in charge of all of us, and it got crazy because there was no reason for them to be making PCs, but they were able to make a PC that had a built-in mouse chip that worked with an Amiga or a Commodore 64, I forget, one of those mice. And that was like, that was their big innovation, was it's got a built-in mouse chip that works with a special mouse that nobody in the PC industry has. I mean, they were kind of, they were not focused on what they needed to do, and they couldn't, there were too many PCs you needed to have. No matter what, they end up having to OEM. In fact, that's when they really found out what the price difference was, is that they needed like a, I don't know if it was a 386 or a 486 PC in Germany, and our guys had nowhere near enough time to do that, so they went out and bought one, and they were paying less for that than they were for the model down from it that was made in Commodore. Like, significantly less. Okay.
I also heard that from, I heard from Henry Rubin at the end of his stay at Commodore then, that upper management was starting to lose faith in the success of the Amiga, and they were trying to hedge their bets by getting into the PC space as well. But I agree, that just diluted the effort and made things worse instead of making things better. Mm-hmm.
Well, and then there was the sidecar that came early on. It took some people over to Frankfurt. Is that
Braunschweig.
And that was, again, the those folks thinking, oh, we've got to make this into a PC.
Yeah.
We've got to make the Amiga like a PC. So let's put the sidecar on it. And you win. You did it.
I did it, yeah. That was fun.
6 months.
I've got
a sidecar story I should tell. It's fairly brief. In the early medium days of the A3000, I had gotten like the Rev 2 or 3 Buster chip back, and almost everything worked, but the sidecar didn't work. And that became that had Henry running around in a circle one day, and I was like, I will figure this out. It's a new chip. There's probably some quirk of Zorro that they did differently, or I did differently, or whatever. And but I had to get I had to go to the dentist that day, so I left early to get my tooth drilled. And I came. I said, as I was driving home at quite illegal speeds, listening to loud rock music, I realized exactly what was wrong with it. Now, Henry being Henry, there were already Germans on a plane coming over. So, to fix it, because the Germans had designed the whole thing, all the hardware, we didn't really know that much about it. One of our chip guys might have been involved, I don't remember, but it was mostly a German invention, and but I knew Zorro as well as anybody else. I mean, I kind of invented some of the later stuff in Zorro, and so I got my tooth drilled, and I said, I'm going back. So I went back, and apparently the Germans had been there, and then they went back to the hotel to get showers or food or beer or who knows what Germans do when you're not watching. So I said, okay, I know what this is. I made a little hack on the bridge card itself. This was bridge card days. It wasn't actually sidecar, but same technology. So I did a little hack on the bridge card. I knew the problem was actually in the Buster chip, but I knew it was a Zorro 2 issue that was just, it was kind of a little quirky thing, and it was based on the way they were doing things. They weren't wrong. They were just doing things a little differently than I had imagined things being done. So I did a hack, fired it up. Yeah, DOS booted. I wrote a little shell script. Command prompt script, whatever, that just looped and said it works or something like that, and then I went home. And of course the Germans had no idea I'd even been there, so they came in and all of a sudden, like, we're here and it's working. And
break it for us.
I think that was the last time Henry didn't listen when I said something like, oh, I'll be able to fix it pretty quickly.
This is a question for Carl. Original Amiga OS was developed in BCPL. How did you make that choice?
Oh, that's a really good question. Yeah, one of my heartaches, actually. That's the story of a heartache. So, from the beginning of Amiga operating system design, there were two components. One was really the kernel, and then there were all libraries and things that went on top that, they gave the machine its features, the graphics and sound and the user interface and all that. But there's also the file system side of things. And we had a company that we contracted with that was down in Arizona that knew a lot about Unix-style operating systems, and they promised us that they could make something similar to Unix file system for the Amiga. And the original specs looked really pretty good, and so we contracted them to do it. But the months went by, and nothing much happened. And the months continued to go by, and management was getting nervous. And Dave Morris was getting nervous. Everyone was getting very nervous that there would be no file system. So in a few days, I wrote a very temporary file system that we could use around the office so that the hardware guys could write little programs or get RJ to write a program or Dale to write a program, put it on a disk, and then load it in, and it would just read sequential sectors off the disk and let them run those programs. But we still had no decent file system. So Tim King from I think he's from Edinburgh, right? I think he was. And he walked in one day and he said, "Hey, I've got this thing TriPOS, and it's got a language BCPL, and I've got this DOS that runs on top of it. And I'd like to show you that I can get this running on the Amiga really quickly." And so I gave him the API to exec, and to his credit, he had it working very quickly on the Amiga. But the problem was, it wasn't really designed for the Amiga. And the way that the file system worked, and the way that it, for instance, delayed write-backs to the disk, was very problematic for a floppy disk machine where someone was going to pop out that disk and while it was being written to. So not only would it not get out there, but often the disk would be destroyed by the fact that the floppy head would be picked up as it's spinning around. So we lost a lot of disks, that was the biggest frustration, and I was very, very upset about it. The other frustration was that the API that he had all these very strange names. You didn't open a file, that was the traditional name in the API. You'd open a file, but it was like, get input handler, I think was the original open, was get input handler. It was like, so I told him, I said, we gotta go off, and we're gonna lock ourselves in a room, and I'm going to rename all your functions for you so that's consistent at least with what most people know of, for programming. So we managed to do that and get most of those. But the problem being based on BCPL was interesting because BCPL was a long word pointer. It had long word pointers. So it pointed to 32-bit pieces of memory. But the rest of the system, which was written in C in assembly code, was a byte pointer. So these pointers were not compatible. So if you pass pointers back and forth between the file system and anything else in the operating system, you would blow your program right out of the water most of the time, with an exception. So what makes the story interesting is after I left Amiga, the phone rang early one morning, and I picked it up. And on the phone, it's like, "Is this Carl Sassenrath?" And actually, it was Irving Gould. And he was saying, "This file system that's on the Amiga isn't so good." I said, "Well, yes, I know, it's horrible, it's awful." He said, "Well, can you come back and fix it?" And I was like, "No, because that's the file system, all of those programs now use that structure." And I think I was an idiot, and I was probably a little idealistic, okay, to not come back and to do at least something to fix that, because for years afterwards, that file system that was based on TriPOS caused all these problems with people's disks. So, did that answer your question?
Time for one final question.
One final question.
Make it good.
Yeah. Don't ask about DOS again.
I have a short follow-up on.
Oh, shoot.
I think it's for you, Carl. The TriPOS, what was his state of mind? Calm and relaxed and struggling?
Oh, I can tell you. So
B pointers, conversions.
Yeah, we disliked it so much. The guy I was working with, who was writing the floppy disk driver, Neil Caton, was a real good programmer. And he was the one that was doing that, the lower level driver for the floppy disk. And we looked at each other and we said, "No, there's no way we're going to accept this." So we actually went to Dave Morris, the two of us together, and we said, "We will lock ourselves in a room for a week and we will write a good file system for the Amiga. But we need you to let us do that." Like, just like RJ locked himself in a room to create Intuition, this was before that. And he said, "No." And I said, "Well, we really need to do this." He said, "No. We just can't, there's something there, it works, we'll use it." And so it was just like, my heart.
It was fun, relaxed.
Okay. Yeah, well, no. No fun, no relaxation. Yeah.
Okay.
It is sad. The reason that Irving called Carl is because I told Irving you ought to call Carl, because it was like the thing that held the Amiga back, and it's really unfortunate is that at least we had a file system, but the guys that cheated us out of the original plan and didn't deliver, the file system itself, I think, is the thing that held the Amiga back more than anything else, and it was really a shame that we had a small opportunity there where we could look at doing something different about it, but it didn't happen. And I think looking back on it, if I had to point to one thing other than that marketing department, it would be the file system that we had. Can we end on a question with a more upbeat note? Yeah. One last question, please. There's one back there. It's upbeat, we're promised.
John again. Do you have any fond memories of Chuck Pedal?
For those who don't know it, Chuck Pedal kind of invented the personal computer. The form that it took with the first PET was Chuck's idea. So in the early days of computers, you had a microprocessor and like 1,000 of these little chips, or at least 100, you know, little tiny chips. The IBM PC was a couple, not too many big chips, and all these little chips. Chuck, who invented the 6502, along with some other people, Bill Mensch was in there, but Chuck was like, he was in charge of this, but he had the vision for making a whole personal computer, so that's why you had all these 6522s, and the ones that went into the C64 and all that. That was his idea, that we're not just building a microprocessor, we're building a whole computer. And so when the PET came out, it had lots of big chips in it, and only a few small ones for the era. And it had BASIC, because Chuck had used BASIC at Dartmouth or one of the colleges, and had used larger computers, and thought that a personal computer should be a lot more like a large computer than the hobby computers, where at one point you were flipping switches on the front, and then you're using little keypads like in the Kim one. So I didn't know Chuck during the era that he worked at Commodore. I ran into him at computer shows and we got a really good talk for him at the VCF East some years back, even though he was supposed to be there in person and ended up doing a Skype from Sri Lanka because he had a company there that needed his attention that week. But I mean, just the fact that, like, you know, because when I got out of college, I knew a lot about computers, but going in, my first personal computer experience was on a PET 2001. My friend Scott bought in like 77 or 78, right when they first came out. I went to Manhattan, you know, the island of Manhattan, part of New York City, to buy a computer with my friend Scott. And there was one store in all of Manhattan that sold a PET 2001, and it wasn't really a store, it was a little one-room building in an office building. You go in there, and they had some boxes in the back room, and they had one side of the building had the PET 2001, 8K of RAM, and 14K of ROM, I think it was. And the other side, there was the Apple II, just two, not two anything else, and it had 4K of RAM. And it did color, but it had like this machine language monitor. It didn't speak BASIC at the time, or it had some really small BASIC or something like that. You got the PET, and it was like a fully formed computer. You could edit your BASIC programs. You didn't just have to type the lines over. You had a screen editor. It was like, wow, this is better than I had. Yeah, this is better than I had anything I had seen. Because I was used to doing online stuff with dial-up computers and thermal paper and stuff like that. So, you know, that was my first real computer. It's my buddy's computer, but he knew how to program, so I got to use it a lot. and you can tell that, you know, I was kind of a geek even as a teenager.
What's this got to do with Chuck Pedal?
Chuck Pedal invented it.
Ah, okay, yay!
But I digress.
Okay, guys, we have to end it here, unfortunately. But you'll be here.
Yeah, we'll be here.
Any questions you got? Okay, I got one more thing for the raffle, which is this.
Yeah. Oh!
My name's on the motherboard.
I knew water to give it away to you because you love the model. I heard some great oohs here. I think it's time for Only the Amiga. Shall we do that? Just Only Amiga. Okay. Ready? 3, 2, 1.
Only Amiga.
Okay, just like your thing. Okay, you better be here. It's the prettiest A2000 we could find with a great new keyboard, new mouse, generalism. You know numbers.
744.
744.
744. Going one.
Might be outside.
Dilemma.
Dilemma. Dilemma. Your number is 635. I used to work at a game show. The number is 942. Just can't give this thing away. Your number is 711.
No. The final number, if it doesn't go right, you stick it on it, then you get it.
The number is 980.
Congratulations.
Know what it is?
Yeah.
It's an Amiga, but it's heavy. Oh. You're getting emotional.
Oh,
good.